Hi there, my name is Bob Plankers and I'm a technical marketing architect with VMware Corporation. Let's talk a little bit about all of the new features in vSphere 7. Lots of stuff. Let's see if we can get through them. Lifecycle. What's one of the biggest things in a virtual infrastructure's maintenance, all that? And we've got patching, upgrades. How do you get from 6.5 to 6.7 to 7 and beyond? You know, how do you get to, how do you manage your hardware firmware? How do you manage your hardware configurations? How do you manage your software configurations? All of that. Lifecycle. We call it Lifecycle. Very important. It's been completely reimagined in vSphere 7. Be easier to use, more comprehensive, all of that. It's very, very important, very, very interesting stuff, very, very powerful tool sets now. Speaking of that, vCenter profiles. vCenter server now has the ability to export and import configuration files, pieces of configurations as well. Doesn't have to be the complete configuration. A vCenter server can also subscribe to another vCenter server for configuration data. So you update configuration on one vCenter, and then it trickles down to other ones that are subscribed. That'll be a really interesting thing for large environments, for trying to ease maintenance tasks. All of this is driven by APIs. Massive, massive, massive push to have REST APIs easily consumed in various languages. Go, Ruby, Python, PowerCLI, always PowerCLI. PowerCLI is a very accessible and continues to be a very powerful way to interact with our infrastructures. And this is great for developers, it's great for tools and the whole ecosystem. Very, very important. Especially, you know, for security as well. You know, a lot of people leave SSH on, turn SSH off, use the APIs. You get access control, all of that. Very important. Content library draws on APIs a lot. Content library has seen a lot of improvements in the last updates for vCenter server. Well, vCenter server 7 is no different in that regard. It gains the ability to check in and check out templates, do version control on templates. Very powerful feature. Know who's doing what to your templates and what revisions there are. Storage, we got to put those templates somewhere, right? There's interesting storage options. Storage is always moving forward. New revision of vSAN, NVMe support, NVMe over fabrics. That's an up-and-coming technology. Very powerful, very fast. We also have the ability to do Windows Server failover clustering against a VMDK now as well, helping to simplify an environment by removing, being able to remove RDMs, those complicated RDMs. It can all be virtual now. Very interesting technology. Speaking of physical hardware, storage is very physical. On the server side of things, we've got these newfangled creations called GPUs, we've got FPGAs, we've got SmartNICs, all of this. How do we deal with that? So again, in the reimagining of how this works, we've got something called assignable hardware. Assignable hardware is where a VM can be attached to dynamically to these resources based on rule sets. You can, it's very configurable, and it helps enable vMotion, you know, a machine, a VM running against a GPU can move to another host that's got a GPU and just auto-attach. Very powerful. All of this is driven by a new hardware version, new virtual hardware version, hardware version 17. It has support for all of these things, all of the physical advances. It's also got VSGX, the software guard extensions from Intel that are available on certain CPUs. We can expose those to a workload. So if you've got an application that likes to keep secrets, wants to keep secrets, then it's a very interesting way to do that. It can create a secure enclave in the hardware memory that neither the guest OS nor the hypervisor can see into. Very powerful, very interesting technology. We also have precision time clocks, PTP, precision time protocol support. We can add a precision clock device to a piece of hardware and get sub-millisecond time accuracy. Very important for financial sector, very important for scientific applications as well. Last, we have got virtual watchdogs. The idea that a piece of watchdog process can help inform whether a guest OS in a cluster, in a clustered situation, you always want to know if your partners are up for doing work and, you know, take action if they're not. Well, this watchdog can help us do that. Hey, are you healthy? Yeah, maybe not. We can recycle it, that sort of thing. security. We're always trying to make security easy to use, easy to implement, and vSphere secure by default. Lots of new security security defaults, lots of out-of-the-box improvements to security, and including the vSphere Trust Authority. vSphere Trust Authority is a technology very foundational that helps us drive trust, helps us drive attestation and configuration verification, boot verification using cryptographic methods. We can verify whether a host booted with known good software, software from VMware or our trusted partners, in a configuration that we approve of. And unlike previous versions, if that isn't true, we can now prevent our encrypted workloads, we can prevent our other workloads from moving on to those untrusted hosts. That's very powerful, and it sets the stage for a lot of things to come. We also have identity federation. This is going to be giant. The idea that we can kick out all of the authentication, we can move that off to our enterprise identity providers. Let them deal with it, let them deal with the corporate processes for onboarding, user management, all of that stuff. We still have SSO, still have all of the legacy options for the vSphere admin teams and things, but all that user management somewhere else. We can inject multi-factor authentication, which is a huge thing for security and compliance. And for compliance, it also reduces the audit scope of compliance audits. Very important. Last and definitely not least, the two things that really power our infrastructures, our vSphere infrastructures, DRS and vMotion. DRS has gained a lot of improvements. It's much different than the classic DRS that we're used to. It considers workloads more carefully, a lot more metrics around the workloads, the hardware. You know, we talked about all this new hardware support. It's got a lot of that support in it. What hardware can it attach to? Where can it move? That sort of thing. Very powerful improvements there. Very worth looking at. And then vMotion. How does DRS get clusters balanced? vMotion. vMotion, faster, lower stun times. This is really important for big VMs especially, but even small VMs will benefit from this as well. Higher throughputs. That sort of thing. And last, we can move an encrypted VM now. Using cross vCenter vMotion, we can move a VM from one vCenter to another. We used to not be able to do that because it couldn't exchange the keys. We had to decrypt it, move it, and then re-encrypt it. And that took time. Now it can exchange the keys and we can move that across seamlessly, which helps hybrid clouds, helps on-premises, all kinds of things. So as you can see, lots of new features in vSphere 7. There's a whole bunch of things, littler things, performance improvements, all of that I haven't talked about. Definitely check out the release notes, check out the documentation, vSphereCentral.vmware.com, very important resource as well. Thank you very much and have a good day.